This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today, we've got a guest on this show who is among the more famous people, especially in our community of UFO investigators, researchers, experiencers, and all sorts of adventurers at the edge of reality, Jimmy Church. His show, of course, is Fade to Black on the Game Changer Radio Network. It's syndicated on KGRA, TuneIn, Spreaker, and where else is it, Jimmy? It's all over the place.
If you just go to the website, Whitley, everybody out there. And thank you, Whitley. This is an honor and a pleasure to once again hang out with you. Just visit my website, jimmychurchradio.com, and everybody these days, Whitley, they have their own little comfort zone where they like to go and listen and view and watch and research. And yeah, we pretty much have all of that covered on the website. So wherever it is that you like to hang out, just visit the website and you can come and check us out.
And Jimmy's show is live Monday through Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific time. That means 8 o'clock Mountain and 10 o'clock Eastern time, if there still is an Eastern Seaboard, which is up for grabs right now.
Man.
Boy.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable. And, you know, I when I wrote Superstorm with Art, neither of us would have thought that by 2020 it would be this far gone, but it is, boy. I just published a new Whitley's Journal on my website, and it's called The New Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, which are flood, fire, storm, and drought. All right, so now let's go on, though. Jimmy, what we want to do today is to basically talk about the state of the community and the things that are happening kind of on the edge right now, because there's a lot going on. We've got such things as Anjali Schultz is out there. You've had her on your show recently. Why don't we start out talking about that? It's an interesting subject. I've talked to Anjali on the phone, and I haven't interviewed her on Dreamland yet because I'm unsure as to exactly where that's all going. And I thought your interview with her, and folks, you should go to Jimmy's website and listen. This is an extremely good interview. It's really, I mean, Jimmy's not called a pro because he's not a pro. He is a pro. But tell us about how you came to interview her. Let me ask you that.
Yeah, well, all things require a little bit of a backstory. So, and I'll make this as quick as possible because right now, well, okay, let's get to the backstory. You are who I have learned from. Okay. And I go way back with you, Whitley, and listening to your interviews. And the reason why I bring that up, if we go back, you know, to the things that you have gone through for decades in the UFO community, where things have come and gone, you know, things are cyclical and we have these peaks and valleys. And the UFO community, certainly if you go back to the 80s and the 90s, pre-internet, pre-everything, pre-texting, pre-live streaming, those lulls were bigger, right? They were a little further apart because we had to get information from a UFO conference or for a recently published book, or maybe a documentary has come out and somehow you had to view a videotape. All right, but we got used to those lulls. Today, Whitley, there are no lulls in the UFO community. Everything is rapid fire, go, 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 just like the rest of the world. And so hot on the heels of any subject that we can bring out, talk about, and kind of resolve immediately after that, or on top of it, we've got another situation and a piece of knowledge and something to research and something to check out. And it has been like that, as you know, especially over the last 3 years, 4 years, it's been crazy time. And you and I are in constant communication and we're always doing things together.
Yes.
Including in a couple of weeks. Well, we just got done with something a week ago and the week before that. And now we'll be doing the Conscious Life Expo coming up in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
There'll be something breaking before then. So between the last time that I saw you and now, we have Anjali. And hot on the heels, Whitley, of the UAP Task Force report and the things coming from Lou Elizondo. We have J.J. Abrams and Showtime and a new series on Netflix and movies that have been released and right?
Yeah. Now,
Anjali, okay, the UFO community jumped on this pretty quickly. We are in the middle of this disclosure discussion. It's happening everywhere. And you can tap into a disclosure idea from the Senate Intelligence Committee. You can jump into it with Lou Elizondo. You can jump into it with the DOD, the United States Navy pilots. Wherever you want to go, disclosure is out there. And then Anjali comes out and says, hey, ET's ready. We're going to disclose with ET before the end of 2021. Now, that right there, in the midst of everything, the community is all over it because they feel it. You feel it, Whitley. That's all we talk about. And so when this came out and I started to look into this, I immediately got links. I was hearing about this ramping up. And then she did a live press conference in front of the Lincoln Memorial, which was streamed live on YouTube. I watched it. I sat right here in the bunker and I watched it from beginning to end and immediately got on the phone and started to ask questions and see what I could find out. Now, I'll hand this back to you for another question, but let me say this first. We all want this to happen, which is there is an underground extraterrestrial base somewhere in the Mojave Desert. She went into this underground base that we can discuss all of the details in a minute and was met by multiple species of ET face to face. And since then, and that was in 2018, since then, they have been in communication with her and they have let her know that they are ready. And she's using the word soft, a soft disclosure. And she is being allowed to assemble a team. She's saying scientists and researchers, and there, I have a much more detail on this. Some of it I can discuss. We'll come back to that. Let's circle back and come in and meet ET and get evidence. Now, what is evidence? We'll talk about all of that. And then there we have this, and it's supposed to happen before 2021. I want it to happen. It has to happen. You can't go this far forward and not have it happen. There can't be any excuses. And the UFO community, and once the rest of the world continues to pick up on the story, you can't have a Geraldo Rivera, Al Capone's vault situation. Right. That is not allowed. And I certainly won't participate in any of that. No, actually, hold on. That's an untruth. I would participate in an Al Capone's vault situation. We have to go and figure it out and see what's going on for ourselves.
Yes.
It's a very interesting situation we find ourselves in.
Well, when I first heard about it, I thought to myself, this is the second time in 2 years that this has happened. There was another less well-publicized one last year when another individual announced that this would happen in March of last year, and it didn't. And it's only one of a long, long string of such things. And yet, at the same time, this is different in a number of ways. First of all, as I said in the last sentence of my book about contact, A New World, is it is time. And it is. They always told me that they would emerge if necessary, if we couldn't hold the planet's environment together and we were in danger of going extinct. And I frankly think we are. I think that situation has arisen. So, but let's go back to, you mentioned just briefly that you know something about the people on the team, because I know that she has a list of people for this team. In other words, it's been pre-chosen pretty much. What do you know about that, if I may ask? That's not in confidence, because if she's told you things in confidence, obviously we don't want to repeat them here.
Yes. Okay. And I'll say this out of respect to Anjali, but also to you and to your audience. I have not signed an NDA. Okay. But I may. So out of respect to that, I shouldn't really say too much now, because it just wouldn't be cool. She is in the middle of trying to get this stuff done, and there's a certain amount of trust that needs to be there with all parties. Okay, so I'll say that. But let me say what I can. I do know that she is active in assembling this. I know this as a fact. The team, that there are serious concerns, and I've heard her verbalize this and privately, location, identities, and people and things are absolutely paramount. And that's it. So I'm not gonna in any way jeopardize or blow that. I want this thing to happen.
But yeah, me too.
I do know that things are moving forward, and yes, I've been exposed to a limited amount of information, and so in me saying that, I just want the community to know that at this stage of the game, it's a real project. How it concludes, I don't know, but it's pretty interesting at this point. And then I'll say this too as well for the audience. Whitley, without exposing yourself or exposing myself, I'm not going to do that. But Whitley knows, okay? Whitley knows that this thing is pretty interesting. And that's all I'm going to say. And I'm just talking about the whole sphere of this story. Whitley is a very smart... I'm speaking to the audience. I'm not speaking to you in the third person, Whitley. Whitley is... is a very smart person and has connections and knows how to research and knows how to dive deep and knows how to go and get answers. If those answers are available, Whitley Strieber is going to get them. Whitley called me and just started comparing notes. I'm like, yeah, this is it's pretty interesting, isn't it? Now, okay, staying on the subject, I want to actually go parallel a little bit. In the interview, I asked a couple of questions about the Pentagon and Lou Elizondo. She, Anjali, sent me her CV. All right. So I knew about her jobs and locations and things. And it's pretty interesting, but that's not the point. The point is, in the CV, clearly the Pentagon was listed as a place of employment where she worked. Not for the Pentagon, at the Pentagon. Okay, all right. Well, we have ATIP. We have Lou Elizondo, right? Well, there's an interesting situation. What do we do with that? While all of this is going on, I start to see some of the questions and posts on Reddit and other social media too. I think it was Twitter, bringing up Lou Elizondo and ATIP, and it's an obvious connection, and I get that. So I asked her about this on the show. I said, "Hey, Anjali, you know who Lou Elizondo is?" And she said, "Yes, of course." "Ever see him in the hallway? You know what he looks like now? Do you remember him in the Pentagon?" She said, "No." She said, when he surfaced, I was very interested because of the Pentagon. That's where I worked. This is UFOs and this is it. But I don't know who he is. Never heard his name." Now, that I found pretty interesting. Only in that I'm not expecting her to run into, and she said she wasn't interested in UFOs at the Pentagon. But what was interesting for me is that she did not only recognize him and didn't know anything about ATIP or hear anything about ATIP. It's a direct contradiction to some of the statements made by other people, not her, other people in social media that was claiming that there was a connection with her to ATIP. She said she never heard of ATIP until the announcement. She didn't know Lou Elizondo until his big reveal. So yeah. That's, again, it's all the story, the situation, the encounter, the event is getting more and more interesting by the hour.
Now, when I said earlier that the time is right, let me go into that a little bit more. Many years ago, when I was in more direct verbal contact, I would say, with the visitors, in other words, they were communicating with me, not physically, but very close to it, they gave me a number of pieces of information, among which was that as the planet transformed, a lot of people would go insane. And I see that happening all around me. And not just in the United States, although it's probably one of the leading candidates. But also that they would not emerge unless they had to. And I got the impression that they wouldn't be happy about doing that. In other words, it's going to look like all sweetness and light at first, but then maybe not, right? Because maybe they're going to impose things on us that we are not expecting to be imposed on us by someone from the outside. We're going to be made offers we can't refuse.
Do we have to bring up Arthur C. Clarke in Childhood's End?
Yeah, let's do that, because yeah. I think that's very important. Childhood's End was a prescient book. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your adventure with Childhood's End? Because yeah, we all have them.
And this is the thing, Whitley, and I want to come back. I know that I'm the guest, you're the host, but the truth is we're both hosts, and I will ask you a question or two.
Oh yeah, we've done this already, Jimmy. Believe me, on your show,
because I want to circle back to that first encounter situation when you go face to face with something that is something that you don't know about. Let's just go with that. I want to come back to that. Anyway, Childhood's End. The contact is made, and Arthur C. Clarke presents it in such a way that and I really mean this, that you may have to confront your fears, and most people will react to something visually without understanding necessarily what is inside of a Doberman pincher can look pretty, a pit bull can look pretty intimidating and freak you out, and it may be the nicest, friendliest, lick your face off dog in the world, but we have these premeditated, preconceived notions. And that's what he presents here. So E.T. comes to Earth, but won't expose, in this case, himself, because of his image. And his image was Satan. Looked like Satan. Hooves, horns, red, reptilian eyes, very tall. And
yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, yeah. It was very interesting. So, but he, E.T., wanted to offer the Earth everything that we need to make us happy. Cure diseases, don't have to work, food supplies, free energy, you know, the whole package. All you have to do is go to school, go and learn. If you want to work, go have a job. Whatever makes you happy, you know, boom. But the deal was, okay, so what do? We lay down. We lay down. We haven't even seen the guy. We've only heard his voice, and he's going through an ambassador. But we lay down. We accept the terms of the agreement. When in reality, they were going to steal our children, childhood's end, right? Childhood's end, and blow up the planet.
Right, exactly. Exactly. And isn't this the sort of thing that we really do need to think about? And we've been thinking about it for a long time, because this is primarily an American situation, and it is primarily a military program.
Right.
And it is called, the recent release is called a threat assessment. Now, I know a lot of lovely people who don't think there's a threat here. And I know a lot of lovely people who think there's a very serious threat here. And then there are people like me who, having grown up in the poker capital of the United States, Texas, at least in my opinion, I always say, yeah, well, I'd like to cut the cards. And that's kind of where we are now. Will we be given a chance to cut the cards? And we're going to be talking about this Free Dreamlanders more in just a minute. This will be the only break in this show, because there's an awful lot to get to. And I urge you to go to Jimmy's website. Go to, is it jimmychurchradio.com? Yes.
That's it. Yeah, yeah.
And become a fader not. Do this. Get involved. All of us should do these things. We need to make this all happen, and we do that together. He's got a wonderful community. He's got a fabulous show. I love him dearly, and you should too. So, okay. Now, enjoy these commercials.
Support unknowncountry.com and his great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world, because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place, and above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. We're talking to Jimmy Church. His show, of course, is Fade to Black, jimmychurchradio.com. He appears Monday through Thursday nights live at 7 o'clock Pacific, 8 o'clock Mountain, and 10 o'clock Eastern, assuming there still is an Eastern out there. We're hoping for the best. Okay, Jimmy, before we stopped, or paused, I should say, we were beginning to talk about the issue of the childhood's end issue. And there's something incredibly creepy now about that book. And what it is the abduction phenomenon involved the extraction of semen and eggs and all and undoubtedly other types of genetic material. And the creation of apparently of hybrids or something. And why do I say that with such certainty? Because one of them came into my life, in Anne's life. We saw it, interacted with this person. He was real. And he was not like us. For one thing, he could read minds. For another, he not only could read minds, he couldn't stop. And it was driving him crazy. He could not stop. Okay, so all that's there. Now, we get into a situation where they do come out in public, where video that is undeniable comes out of that cave. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask you to think aloud about what happens next. I said aloud, Jimmy.
Yeah. And I can do that. Okay, I want this to happen so bad, like we all do, right? But be careful what you wish for. There's no question about that. We are enjoying this moment as a community, what is going on with the discussion of ET and this reality, and what does the government know? What are the pilot and the Navy? And that finally we're getting this recognition and we've got all the coverage that we can handle. We've yelled for this for decades. Now it's here. Okay. All right. Now the world hasn't freaked out yet.
No, the world has no idea what's happening.
Right. The world hasn't freaked out. We think the world is part of our little bubble in our sphere, that they suddenly get it and all of this exposure. Well, I'm not so sure. And when you talk to most people outside of the UFO community about these subjects, if you have access to them and you bring it up, the answer is a pretty general one. Of course, we're not alone. Universe is too big. Milky Way is too big. We're not alone. This isn't a big deal. I've got to get back to work. I've got shopping to do. I got to pick up my kids from school. I get that. I understand. It's a whole nother situation when you have a childhood's end scenario in front of you. Or you have a craft over New York. You have a live video feed from this cave with ET, suddenly standing there in front and the world sees that. I don't know what that reaction is going to be. And I'm not so sure how, if I'm there, how I would react. There is another part to this, Whitley, where she says, Anjali says she takes the right-hand turn at the end of the cave. Boom, right in front of her are three alien beings. Now, I don't know how I would react in a situation like that. I didn't choose to do this enormous deep dive with Anjali about that moment because we have so much more to discuss and compact into a 2.5-hour show. And we are already halfway through it at this point. But I didn't get a vibe from her. I mean, if it was me, now this is where I'm going to turn this over to you as a host, and you're going to be my guest. If it was me, I think that I would have some pretty amazing details at that moment. And I think that I would spit things out rapid fire. I have met famous people. I've seen crazy things happen, car accidents, things, whatever. One day I rounded the corner in front of my house and there was a body in the street with a sheet over him, police everywhere. That was a bank robber that got shot by the police in front of my house. I can tell you that was 25 years ago, right? That was 1994. I can tell you every detail about that moment. Every single detail, the cars, the thing, what I was wearing, what I was driving, what time, the sun, the moon, I can tell you every single detail, right? And I don't get that with Anjali. And so what was there an emotional thing? Was the thing, what do you see? And when she says curved, everything was curved. Okay. Curved like what? What color? No, what'd you smell? What'd you see? With the floor, the ceiling, the light. You would have all of these things in your brain. I'm not discounting her story. What I'm saying is I didn't get that from her. And the question is why? Does she remember it? Was it blocked out? Did she not pay attention? Was she too excited about seeing ET that she didn't absorb these things around her? And if that's the case, what did you feel from ET? What at that moment, what did you see?
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to hear, well, you know, I large almond eyes. Man, you read that in a book. What did you really see? Right? What did you really feel? And those are the details I'm going to go into another show with her, and I'm going to extract all of that. That's my job. And I'm going to extract it right now from you, Whitley. At that moment, you're face-to-face, man. You're right. What did you feel? What was there? What was that intangible? What was that thing that you've never been exposed to before? What went through your mind? What did you see? I know you've got 1,000 things to say right now.
Well,
what did you see?
It struck me.
What happened?
Let me circle to it. When she was describing her experience on your show, it struck me as strangely lacking in affect, in the sense that it was as if she was seeing people standing in a bus stop. And that's not what it's like for me at all.
That's a really good point.
And I first of all, I've had very few face-to-face encounters. I have never had a face-to-face encounter that's like this encounter with you. Never. And I don't know many people in the close encounter community who have. And it's in part because of the way the mind reacts to phenomena that it has no precedent for. In other words, the human mind is comparative. That's why babies can't figure anything out. Their minds are building a picture of the world. And when something comes into your experience that's completely outside of the picture of the world you have built, believe me, it turns you back into a baby. You are helpless. And not only that, it becomes very malleable. You can't tell what's real and what's not. Like the night of December the 26th, 1985. I look back on it and it's a very complex, strange memory. It has got a lot of emotional content, a sense of claustrophobia, being confined, being trapped. But what it doesn't have is the clarity of my memory of eating my breakfast a couple hours ago.
Interesting.
Doesn't have that. And I would suggest that Anjali's memory of that cave is like a memory of eating breakfast an hour ago. And that's a huge difference. Now, why might it be like that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's a couple of reasons. Obviously, one of them is it didn't happen. Another one is that they controlled the way the people there were experiencing them. And they can certainly do that. I've seen too much to think that's not the case. They can. And they can appear to be things other than what they are.
Right.
They're really very, very skilled at this. And they don't do it with some kind of mysterious technology, I don't think. They do it because they can manipulate the way the brain works inside a person from a distance. And so you're really completely at their mercy when you're with them.
I wrote down, I've been taking notes, and it's interesting that you just gave me reason one and reason two. I'm not playing around about this. I'm going to show this to the camera. I just wrote down a few minutes ago some notes, but I said reasons three and four. and we actually circled around to this detail, which is, I wrote the word detail down. And this is, I wrote saving details for later. And what I mean by that is, if we go to scenario number three, maybe she doesn't want to expose those details. She doesn't want anybody to know. And those are going to be brought out later, but she doesn't want to give away her hand and also pollute the information that is out there. And somebody else may take that information and incorporate it into their own story. So you save those details for yourself. And the reason why I make a point of this to everybody is because I do that. I do that constantly. When I share a story or a detail or this or that, I give you that event, that story's representative, right? I don't give you the details. Why would I do that? I want other details coming back to me from other experiencers, other contactees, abductees, witnesses, whatever it may be, and talk to me. Because if they give me a little nugget that only I know that their story checks out. And I know that, you know what? So does mine. And I'm not crazy. I'm not losing my mind. And this is a possibility for scenario number three. And I think it's something that we should consider at this stage of the game. I would understand not giving away the farm just yet.
Yeah. So I get that. I think that's a wise approach. And of course, you know, I look on Twitter and there are people just trying to say anything they can about her to discredit her. And I think that's out of fear that she's making a big splash and nothing's going to come of it and it's going to make the community look ridiculous. And I understand that too. However, at the same time, it is time for this to happen. And because at least in the scenarios that they presented to me so many years ago, this is when it should happen.
Yeah,
cannot reiterate enough, the fact that it's going to happen or it will happen, it may happen, isn't something they wanted. They didn't want this to happen. It'll be happening because it has to. And that gets me back to childhood's end, their power, their ability to enforce and how far it goes. Because, you know, this planet is a wild place and it's filled with people who will not do anything to save themselves from climate change. There are plenty of climate change deniers probably listening to this show right now and saying, oh, it's just another 500-year storm that happened, the same one as that happened a couple weeks ago in Germany. So what are they going to do? Are they going to, I would think that if they come out and their objective is to save the species and save the planet, then they're going to get pretty controlling, I would think. Well,
Whitley, if we, if we as humans had the ability to go full on interstellar, and maybe we do, okay, I don't know everything, but let's just say we were interstellar, and out of the, you know, 40, 50, 80 billion Earth-like planets in our Milky Way, we start checking some of those out, and we find one that is beautiful, it's blue, it's happening, and we want to start vacationing there, kind of thing, and it's really cool. But we find out that there is damage to the atmosphere, maybe from a species that lives there or not. Okay, maybe there was a solar wind that came through and some corona mass ejection, and the atmosphere was in danger of collapsing. Wouldn't we be concerned with that? Of course we would be. That's it. We would want to save that planet if we had the ability to. And if there was a species on that planet that was doing something to screw it up and they weren't aware of it, would we help them? Would we assist? Would we mention it? Would we make them aware of it? We would.
We definitely would.
Yeah. And so why is this such a E.T. always wants to just save this planet for us, man. It's just like, man, this has just turned into pop culture. This is now folklore. No, it's not. We would do the same thing. We do this in countries and cities on this planet. If there's something bad going on, we try to fix it. It's really that simple.
Well, we're trying that right now all over the United States. We're trying to put out fires. We're trying to help people whose lives are destroyed by Ida. In Germany, they're doing it because so many people lost their homes and everything they possessed.
And electric cars. How about, I'm just throwing some more stuff onto the pile about this. You remember leaded gasoline?
Yeah, sure.
That was really bad stuff, right?
Right.
We stopped with that, but would E.T. be concerned? Absolutely. Is a beautiful blue planet like ours rare? I would say that it is.
My guess is it's very rare.
Out of 80 billion rocky Earth-like planets in our Milky Way, how many have Las Vegas? Right? How many have beaches?
I love the way you think, Jimmy.
how many have beautiful blue beaches and blue? How many are like that? I don't know, but it's probably a pretty fun number. It's a number that you would want to make sure continues. And if we're part of that number, I'm hoping somebody out there wants us to continue for them too as well. And it's not even worth laughing about or arguing about. And I want to swing back. I'm talking about the community or the rest of the world. It's a point not worth arguing. But I want to get back to your point about discrediting Anjali. And I like the way you say her name. I say Anjali, you say tomato. you're obviously correct. You're the smart one in this room right now. But discredit. No,
don't say that, Jimmy. Don't try to disguise yourself with me. You are a very smart man, and you know a hell of a lot about this stuff.
It's a mask. It's smoke and mirrors, Whitley. But thank you for that. But let's go back to discrediting, because there isn't anybody in this community that is immune. You, Dolan, Linda, Stanton Friedman, right? And then you could, everybody has been a target, myself, right? Art Bell, George Norrie, everybody is a target in this community, and we've all taken our shots. And sometimes I've got so many arrows in my back, Whitley, you're walking down the street, just pulling them out,
I know the feeling.
Yes, you do. And so right now, she is in a position of visibility. And when that happens, people are going to just go after her because they do it for sport. They don't do it with anything to back it up. And in most cases, it's all made up. You know as well as I do, I can go down a list of things that, you know, I have literally been accused of. I know for a fact that Jimmy Church is on the payroll for the CIA. I've seen his check stubs.
Just stop with...
Stop. Yeah. Right. Well, that happened to me. William Moore, who wrote Behold a Pale Horse, has in the book or had somewhere this fake letter from John Alexander activating me and Dick Hoagland.
I remember
activating
that.
Us in quotes. And, you know, it never happened. It's simply made up. He invented it.
Oh, man. Willie, I know you so well. That is just... That is awesome creative writing. Okay, let's go, man. Willie Strieber.
Yeah.
Let's generate this letter. That's pretty good.
Okay. Now, we're going to talk in the last half hour about something that I have discovered is known in the inner circles of the military and so forth in the Chris Mellon, Lou Elizondo world. As the woo factor, which I'm having a lot of problems with, the fact that it's called that even. But we're not going to talk about that right now. What I want to talk about right now is the trajectory here. 2017, Lou Elizondo suddenly comes out with this stuff. It's picked up by, thanks to Leslie Keene and Ralph Blumenthal, by the New York Times. And it begins the process of fundamental world change at every level, from culture to science to technology to everything. And we have spent the last just over 100 years in the process of realizing that the universe wasn't just bigger than we thought. It was much, much, much bigger than we thought. And now we are going to be facing the reality that not only is it much bigger than we thought, but that rare though Earths may be, there are entities out there who can traverse this universe for whatever reason. And they are here. But what about the original motivation of someone like Lou Elizondo? He's working on a secret program. He gets angry when his budget is screwed with. And so what does he do? But apparently, without much pushback at all from the Pentagon or from the Defense Department, he violates his confidentiality agreement, his security clearance. Big time. What's the play of motivations that you see here?
If we take things in its totality, okay, let's go with that. Because around Lou at that time, not only we have ATIP and Harry Reid, we have Bigelow, that entire team that was, part of Bass and NIDS, where we have this very specific circle of people, and then Tom DeLonge and TTSA rolls into town. And then we have this list of individuals with TTSA and their live press conference, because at that time, Lou resigned, I believe, like the day before.
Right.
Okay, so they go live on the air. They do the live stream. And he's introducing everybody. Lou Elizondo steps up to the camera after the introduction and says, I resigned yesterday. This is too important for me. And this is so now let's stop right there. He resigned the day before. He was already in communication with the media. TTSA is rolling this out. There's a marketing campaign. They are now selling stock. This is a public offer. And behind the scenes, we've got, you know, Semivan and Steve Justice and Chris Mellon, of course, Lou, Hal Putoff, and a team of people. If you go down that list, CIA, Department of Defense, counterintelligence. When you look at that assembly of an NECV from Semivan all the way down to Putoff, save for Tom DeLonge, and he may be counterintelligence too, I don't know. That if that is
whatever is counter, it's not intelligence. Go ahead.
Yes, right. Well done, Whitley. Is this the job for everybody? Is creating their own message. That's their job. That's what the CIA does.
Right.
That's what counterintelligence professionals do. That's what you do. Department of Defense. It's exactly your gig. And that was Lou's gig, and that was everybody else's gig. So was this all planned? I mean, Steve Justice, Chris Mellon, you know, Hal Putoff, Semivan, didn't just the day before go, you know what, I'm going to do this UFO thing. No, this was planned, set up, stories are in place, they are ready to go and to move forward. This is a big organization. This was orchestrated, planned, noted, edited, filed, and prepped. Okay, Lou was part of that. Lou is in the middle of this message. Now, what is it? What's the message? Now, we're dealing with the CIA and the military here. I don't see Whitley Strieber on the payroll. I don't see Linda Moulton Howe. I don't see Richard Dolan. I don't see anybody from any civilian aspect of this. The message clearly is from the Pentagon. It's a clear message from the establishment. It's a clear message from agencies and how they want to move forward. The same people that have been doing it going back to the 70s.
Right.
And moving forward, this is not something brand new. This isn't a Gen Z situation with fresh minds and a fresh approach. This is clearly an old school prepped, done,
right,
that was approved by Washington, D.C. It wasn't from any, they didn't come talk. Well, they did kind of. They did approach me, but I decided to back out. When I, okay, I'm just going to say this. I might have said it on the air, but I'll say this. I haven't signed a confidentiality agreement with anybody, but I do keep things close to my chest. I was approached along with somebody else that you and I know pretty well, Whitley. I was approached, and they said, hey, can you help us get this message out? We would like some other journalists, some other people in the media. And if you could go ahead and put a short list together, we would like to reach out to those people. And me and this other person of note that we all know replied back. And I can say no more. I'm not going to say anything else.
Okay.
But when I started to have these questions about the CIA and what was going on, I had to back up. I had to back up, and there was a lot of negative things that were said back and forth that I wasn't being a good boy. I was asking too many questions, that I need to get on the team. I need to understand that they are smarter than I am. Their words, not mine, that they really know the real agenda, that they really know what's happening and they know how to handle this. I don't. And I said, you know what? Go screw yourselves. You know, you guys are on your own.
That kind of, that's called hubris. And, yeah. and the gods always found it very annoying. And I'm afraid it's still true. We're approaching the top of the first hour. And in the last half hour, we're going to be talking, as I said a moment ago, about something called, that as I've discovered, is called the woo factor. That essentially is us, the Close Encounter Witnesses. And what happens to us? Nobody's asked me to be on any teams. In fact, a lot of the people who you just named are afraid to even talk to me because of the implant in my ear. Mm-hmm. They think of me as being a kind of shill for evil aliens. And therefore, the whole community of experiencers is, I think, in jeopardy. What happens if the threat assessment becomes officially recognized as a threat to the United States of America and its integrity as a nation? Then what happens to the people like me and like thousands and thousands of other Americans and people around the world who are hooked up in one way or another with the visitors? This is a huge question. Now, I want you to stop because this is the end of the first hour. And Free Dreamlanders, this is also the moment when we have to say goodbye. And stay with us, subscribers. We're just going to keep right on keeping on as always as we go into discussing what I believe to be probably the single most important topic that will be that exists in this whole issue of contact and that will be assiduously and carefully ignored by all of the people that we have just been talking about, including, I would suspect, Anjali. We're the woo factor. We are also the elephant in the living room.
Mm-hmm.
We are also the people you can't do this without, not successfully. Free Dreamlanders, thank you for being with us.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.